For more than two decades now, the lands of Southeast Asia have been torn by conflict. During this time, the people of Vietnam have seen bitter wars against the Japanese and the French. Now, with their country divided between Communist North and Nationalist South, the fighting continues. Since 1957, Communist-backed Viet Cong guerrillas in the South have been engaged in a campaign of terrorist attacks against the government of President Diem. In 1959, the leader of the Communist North, Ho Chi Minh, announces his intention to reunite the entire country through armed struggle. The conflict escalates as regular units of the North Vietnamese Army infiltrate south through the jungles of neighboring Laos and Cambodia to join up with the Viet Cong. The United States has been supplying assistance to South Vietnam since the Eisenhower administration, as part of its policy to combat what was seen as the domino effect of communist expansion in the region. By 1961, despite millions of dollars in US aid, the South Vietnamese army are losing in their struggle against the communist guerrillas. General Maxwell Taylor is sent to Vietnam on a fact-finding mission for the US government. Making a tour of the country, it takes little time for him to realize that the geography of Vietnam is perhaps the single biggest factor hampering the fight against the Viet Cong. South Vietnam has three principal geographic areas. From the sea, a narrow coastal plain stretches inland for a distance of no more than 15 miles, where it meets the second feature, the Annam Central Highlands. The Central Highlands are a range of steep jungle-covered mountains which run south from the demilitarized zone to within 30 miles of Saigon. The south of the country is covered by the arable plains of the Mekong Delta. Here, amongst the 3,000 miles of navigable waterways, the land is a mixture of low forest, dense mangrove swamps, and rice paddies. Most of the major towns and cities are concentrated along the coastal plain, leaving vast, sparsely populated areas in which the Viet Cong are free to roam unchecked. In his report, General Taylor concludes that to be effective in a war of counterinsurgency in such an environment would require the commitment of sizable US ground forces. Until now, America's contribution to the war has been restricted to supplying equipment and military advisors to train elements of the South Vietnamese Army. And although Washington is still reluctant to commit their own troops, they agree to provide immediate additional aid to the region. Within weeks of their decision, a new sound is heard over the jungles of Vietnam. US advisors accompany South Vietnamese paratroops on an assault against Viet Cong positions. The paratroops are transported into the area not by parachute, but by US Army helicopters, part of the latest package of military aid. More helicopters are sent to Vietnam in the new year. Reports of their success are greeted with caution in military circles, but they attract the interest of the Secretary of State for Defense, Robert McNamara. The Defense Secretary calls for a study to be made into the potential of air mobility and the helicopter in the US Army. By the time the report is completed, many of its findings are already being put into practice. The Army has formed its first specialized company for armed helicopters to provide escorts for the troop transports. Recovering from the shock caused by the first helicopters, the Viet Cong have found that for all their speed and mobility, these machines are particularly vulnerable to small arms fire at the critical times during landing and takeoff. Quick to exploit this weakness, the guerrillas are making the job of ferrying assault troops increasingly hazardous. Now the helicopters will respond in kind. Fitted with a variety of machine guns and rockets, the Utility Tactical Transport Helicopter Company are dispatched for duties in Vietnam. With more of their helicopters en route for combat, a major overhaul is on the way for US Army Aviation. For months, trials have been taking place at military aviation schools around the country. Their work, along with recommendations from the study for the Defense Secretary, will now be combined in an intensive development program for the use of helicopters in combat. In January of 1963, an air assault test division is established at Fort Benning, Georgia. The new unit revives the colors of the old 11th Airborne Division, and veteran flyers and experts are brought together in an effort to put some of these recommendations into practice. The central idea put forward in the report is the concept of the Air Assault Division, a new type of army division with air mobility as its highest priority. The concept of air mobility is not entirely new. During World War II, forces on both sides had used aircraft for rapid troop deployment and to provide a form of airborne artillery in support of armored or infantry units. Although parachutes, gliders, and dive bombers had all provided individual elements of air mobility, the pace of battle had still been determined by the speed of soldiers on the ground. The aim now is to develop a unit in which all aspects of troop movements, intelligence, command and control, firepower, and logistical support would be provided by aircraft which were organic to the army itself. The workhorse of air mobility will be the Bell UH-1 Iroquois, the Huey, originally designed as an air ambulance and now working in Vietnam in the role of escort gunship, this helicopter has already proved itself to have many of the characteristics required for this new type of unit. A series of extensive trials are conducted, flying over long distances and in all weather conditions. Low-level flying and the ability to maintain tight formation by day or night are also an essential part of the program. If air mobility is to work, then not only the combat troops, but every aspect of the division must be air transportable. A standard army division numbers over 15,000 personnel. Moving these numbers at short notice will be a massive logistical task. The plan is to raise the division's normal complement of aircraft from 100 to about 450, while at the same time reducing the number of ground vehicles from almost 3,500 to just over 1,000. Other changes would mean that all support material would be restricted to equipment which is transportable by helicopter. In the case of artillery, this will mean a reduction in divisional firepower. But it is envisaged that the shortfall will be compensated for by greater mobility and the introduction of armed reconnaissance aircraft and helicopter gunships. While the Hueys go through their paces, experiments are also underway to devise methods of moving divisional artillery and key supplies. Central to this role is the Boeing Chinook. These twin-rotor helicopters are each capable of carrying more than 40 combat troops, light vehicles, or even a full artillery section with personnel. For more unusual or outsized payloads, the transport commanders can call upon the services of the aptly named Sky Crane. Fixed-wing aircraft will also play a part in the new division. Planes like these Mohawks, fitted with surveillance equipment or light armaments, would perform reconnaissance and support duties, while the larger Caribou would serve as a general transport. Both of these aircraft, capable of operating out of confined or hastily prepared airstrips, would add greatly to divisional mobility. Mindful that they may be called on to send more troops to a war zone, the US Army are paying close attention to every theater of helicopter operations. The escort gunships in Vietnam are no exception. Since November, a special Army concept team based in Saigon have been reporting on the progress of the Hueys under combat conditions. In the first 5 months since their deployment, losses of escorted transports are down by 25%, while operational losses of those without gunship protection have doubled. The only major setback suffered by the helicopters was in an incident during a January assault near the village of Apbak in the Plain of Reeds. Four twin-rotor Shawnees and one Huey were lost in an ambush after they put down in a landing zone surrounded by a detachment of heavily armed and well-entrenched Viet Cong. The area had not been subjected to a pre-strike by fixed-wing aircraft, and for all their efforts, the armed Hueys could not dislodge a well-dug-in force. A costly lesson, but also a timely one, which would ensure that future assaults into this unforgiving territory would have better preparation. Throughout this period, there is a continuous cross-flow of information between Vietnam and the test division at Fort Benning. It is an unusual opportunity for the military planners, who are free from some of the pressures and restrictions of a full-scale war, and at the same time able to put their theories into practice in live situations. Officially, the American forces in Vietnam are there in an advisory capacity. And although this role extends to providing air crews and advisors in the field, US personnel are supposed to be non-combatant. Under these circumstances, rules of engagement are restrictive, and helicopter crews are not allowed to open fire on the enemy unless they or the escorted transports are fired on first. These restrictions preclude the testing of any offensive tactical concepts at this time. On the 26th of February 1963, the rules are changed. Following from an incident in which two helicopters were shot down and a US serviceman killed, the chopper crews are given sanction to initiate fire against targets identified on the ground. Although they remain in name non-combatant and will continue their job of ferrying South Vietnamese troops, no longer bound to shoot second, the choppers will now begin to adopt an offensive role. By mid-1963, the use of helicopters in Vietnam is widespread, and many elements of the air mobility concept are now in practice. Most of the old twin-rotor Shawnees have been replaced, and the Hueys are operating in a whole variety of roles, each with its own distinctive nickname. As troop transports, they are called Slicks, while their escort gunships are referred to simply as Guns. Sporting red crosses and in growing demand, the air ambulance versions are known either as Medivacs or Dust-Offs. Showing little regard for the Geneva Convention, some Viet Cong have found that these red crosses made ideal aiming points. And some crews in response have added door guns to their aircraft. During an aerial assault, the helicopters now follow a well-established pattern, with each operation breaking down into two phases: the en route phase and the approach phase. As yet, Viet Cong have little by way of heavy air defenses. And so the en route flights are made at an altitude of about 1,500 feet. This keeps the choppers out of range of small arms fire, but means that they're visible for quite a distance. The flight formation is determined in the main by two factors: the size and shape of the landing zone and the company commander's requirements for disembarkation. The most commonly used formation is the V, which is easy to control and permits the landing of the flight in a short space of time without bunching. A few miles from the objective, the approach phase begins. The helicopters drop down close to ground level to take advantage of terrain masking. Two or four gunships employed for escort and reconnaissance travel a few minutes ahead of the main group to prepare the landing zone. Prepping, as it's called, involves circling the area to draw enemy fire and shooting into the tree line and any other places in which enemy forces may be concealed. Knowing when the machines are most vulnerable, the Viet Cong frequently hold their fire until the last moment when the helicopters flare, committing themselves to land. A cold landing zone can quickly turn hot, so during this stage, the idea is to put as many of the ships as possible down at the one time. The theory being that this minimizes the chances of the enemy concentrating their fire on one helicopter. It also allows the maximum number of troops to unload and return fire. The gunships remain in the area throughout, circling and laying down suppressive fire until the last of the transports have left. The development of the Air Assault Division had brought with it the need for more trained flyers. An estimated 9,000 pilots would be required by the end of the year, and that figure would be increased to 20,000 by 1968. In order to meet this demand, the officer training program is being revised to allow for an increase in the number of warrant officer commissions. The prospect of flying helicopters held great appeal. And at Fort Walters, Texas, the U.S. Army Primary Helicopter School, hundreds of hopefuls had signed up for the Warrant Officer Program. Here, the candidates will begin their 9 months of intensive training, with 1 month of pre-flight tuition. Before going near a helicopter, they must first understand the basic principles of how these aircraft work. For the next 4 months, each candidate will be with an instructor pilot, spending several hours each day flying small H-23 and H-53 helicopters. They must use this time well, for once they have mastered the rudiments, things become increasingly complicated. Now the instructors may cut the throttle without warning, forcing the pilots to practice auto-rotation, the emergency procedure for landing after the helicopter has suffered an in-flight power failure. In the future, such a power failure may occur over hostile territory as a result of enemy gunfire. At the end of 4 months, the candidates each get to make their first solo flight. Once they've soloed successfully, they will receive their wings and are ready for the next stage of training. Fort Rucker, Alabama, is the location for the U.S. Army's Advanced Helicopter School. The skills acquired at Fort Walters will now be sharpened as pilots concentrate on the more refined aspects of flying. They practice navigating blind, an essential skill for poor visibility and night operations, when all judgments about the helicopter's whereabouts must be made trusting only on readings from the flight instruments. At this point in their training, it is likely that few, if any, of these pilots are aware of the political situation in Vietnam. America itself is undergoing great change, with a growing civil rights movement and the recent assassination of President Kennedy shifting the focus of public attention to domestic matters. Towards the end of their time at Fort Rucker, the pilots get the chance they have waited for. Now, after months of working with the comparatively slow and lumbering trainers, each of them will get to spend 27 hours clocking up flight time on the Huey. The training at Fort Rucker is devised in close consultation with the researchers at Fort Benning and the pilots from Vietnam. And although the maneuvering becomes more realistic day by day, amongst these students, there is still little thought of going to war. In August 1964, U.S. warships patrolling in the Gulf of Tonkin are involved in a series of exchanges with vessels from the North Vietnamese Navy. In the wake of these incidents, Congress passes a resolution giving President Johnson the power to take all necessary measures to repel any armed attacks against forces of the United States and to prevent further aggression. In Johnson's words, the bill is like grandma's nightshirt. It covers everything. It also marks the starting point for a massive escalation in U.S. involvement in Vietnam. Acting with this new freedom, the president initiates a campaign of limited, retaliatory strikes against military targets in North Vietnam. As the year progresses, the attacks carried out by carrier and ground-based aircraft become more frequent, and the range of targets broadens to encompass infiltration routes and Viet Cong staging areas north of the border. Back in the United States, 2 years of developing the techniques of air assault has convinced the military that the concept of air mobility is a viable one. Events since the Gulf of Tonkin clashes have brought ever nearer the time when America will commit ground troops for direct military action in Vietnam. After a final series of war games in the Carolinas, the decision is taken to form a fully fledged air assault division. The 11th Test Division are given the colors of the historic 1st Cavalry, and the process of building them up to full divisional strength is set in motion. The new pilots start to arrive at Fort Benning for yet more training. Here, on a special low-level route called the Confidence Course, the pilots will test their nerve as well as their control technique, and in a few short weeks, put the finishing touches to the skills which they've been developing for the past 9 months. As activity intensifies, rumors abound about the reason for the buildup. This speculation is dismissed. By January of 1965, there are already 23,000 American personnel and hundreds of helicopters at work in Vietnam. It is indeed a chopper war, but it is only the start. Events in the region are developing a momentum of their own. In February, American planes are launched on further retaliatory strikes, the largest so far to take place against the North in response to Viet Cong attacks against air bases at Plai Khu and Khi Nong. The operation, codenamed Flaming Dart, is the start of a series of bombing missions which by March has evolved into the sustained campaign of Operation Rolling Thunder. 3,500 U.S. Marines, the first official combat troops, arrived to protect the airbase at Da Nang. Within weeks, it is decided that they may be committed for direct military action upon request by the South Vietnamese Army. U.S. forces in Vietnam relinquish their advisory mantle and assume the role of a fully fledged combat force. Their numbers increase rapidly, and by mid-1965, there are 70,000 in country. On July the 28th, President Johnson initiates a series of dramatic measures concerning American involvement in the war. The number of U.S. forces in the region will be raised to 125,000, with a twofold increase in the current monthly draft figure. In support of a speech detailing his intention to stand in Vietnam, Johnson adds that he has today ordered to Vietnam the Airmobile Division. Their deployment will almost double the number of helicopters in the region. For all their mobility, transporting an entire division across half the world is a mammoth task. Four aircraft carriers, six troop transports, and seven cargo ships are set aside to move the 1st Cavalry Division with its vehicles, artillery, aircraft, and personnel. Ahead of them, a party of 1,000 men will fly with all the hardware required to begin preparations for their new base. As the USS Boxer arrives off Vietnam, the preparations get underway to disembark. The cavalry find that they'll be living at a camp just north of the village of An Khe in the Central Highlands. Here they will have little of the comforts of Fort Benning, or that of their predecessors, who stayed within the relative security of purpose-built airstrips left by the French. South Vietnam has been divided by the military into four zones, and An Khe is situated halfway along Route 19, between Khi Non on the coast and Plai Khu in the Con Thom Plateau. The new division will be based in the heart of the Second Corps Zone, a region which the Viet Cong consider their own. Their proximity to An Khe village dictates that the cavalry must develop a level of cooperation with the locals. Their industrious neighbors respond in a variety of ways, providing everything from laundry facilities to laborers who help with the job of sandbagging and clearing the ground for what will be the largest heliport in the free world. Despite the friendliness shown by the locals, the nature of this guerrilla war brings with it a paranoia which demands that close checks be made around the areas where local labor is used. For most, the work simply provides additional income. But for some, it is an opportunity to reconnoiter the enemy's base and place markers, which after dark may be used to direct mortar and machine gun fire towards vital installations. Their honeymoon period comes to an abrupt end in October, while the cavalry are still trying to eke out what home comforts they may. Two regiments of the North Vietnamese Army, who had been establishing bases and rest areas in the central highlands, launched an attack besieging a special forces camp at Plai My. The assault is seen as part of a larger attempt by the NVA to split South Vietnam in two by driving a line across the country from the Cambodian border to the coast. Having greeted them ashore only a few weeks before, General Westmoreland decides to use the cavalry to overfly the enemy positions, delivering men and supplies to relieve the base. With the lifting of the siege, the North Vietnamese pull back towards the Cambodian border to regroup. Unwilling to see them get away, Westmoreland orders the cavalry to go on the offensive. After a change of plan, the NVA are at the same time regrouping in the Ia Drang Valley, some 15 miles west of Plai My. On the 14th of November, the 1st Cavalry helicopters move into the valley to a location designated LZ X-ray, where shortly after landing, they come under intense enemy gunfire. The cavalry are outnumbered, but are able to call in massive fire support from aerial units, which include B-52s, and from elements of their own divisional artillery. In the following days, as more reinforcements are flown in to join the battle, the choppers get to play their part in the first real test of air mobility. The US forces are spread over a wide area, and the battle lines moving at such a pace that effective close support requires that fire bases be established at short notice, then redeployed for action in another location almost as quickly. With no fixed battle lines, it is also necessary for the artillery units to supply support for one another during moving operations. A task which requires remarkable coordination, as helicopters move through the air to pick up or set down troops and supplies in areas which were about to or have just recently come under heavy fire. During the operation, thousands of tons of equipment, supplies, and personnel are moved by helicopter. And by the time the cavalry return to base, they have inflicted over 1,200 enemy casualties for 300 on their own side, and the loss of only four helicopters. The aftermath of the Ia Drang Valley operation is a time for both sides to take stock of their respective positions. The past weeks have been a far cry from the war games played in the Carolinas. For many of the pilots logging their flight hours after their first real taste of combat, it is an experience which will have them counting each day till the end of their tour. Ia Drang was also the first engagement fought against large numbers of North Vietnamese regular forces. And it is shown that the mobility provided by helicopters, coupled with their fire support, may be the decisive factor in any future set-piece battle. The lesson is not lost on the North Vietnamese or their Viet Cong allies, and it prompts them to adopt a change of tactics. They resort ever more to a campaign of guerrilla warfare, staging hit-and-run attacks, then melting away into the countryside. Operating without any fixed battle lines makes the war against the Viet Cong an exhaustive and frustrating task. Often the enemy would choose not to fight, vanishing to retreats in the forests and highlands. The US commander in Vietnam, General Westmoreland, has his own theory about how to deal with the problem of his shy foe. If the enemy would not come out and fight, you had to go out, find, fix, and destroy them. This policy, although sound in theory, leads right back to the problem which had brought the helicopters to Vietnam 5 years before. A campaign of search and destroy missions involving every branch of the armed forces would now be mounted across the four tactical areas, south from the demilitarized zone to the swamps of the Mekong Delta. For the choppers, these missions will account for thousands of hours in flying time, dropping troops into designated areas, providing gunship support, and flying vertical replenishment or VERTREP missions to ground-based units in the field. For the pilots, each day is a constant cycle with little break except to rearm, refuel, and then back out to support and collect their own troops again when the sweep is made. Although they're fighting an elusive enemy, the threat to the chopper crews is ever real. In terms of risk, their job ranks only after special forces personnel and that of the long-range reconnaissance operatives working deep in enemy territory. The original Slicks had been designed to carry 10 combat troops and a crew of 4. But alterations dictated by war, including the addition of 300 pounds of armor plate around the pilot seats, has reduced that carrying capacity to just 8. Traveling ahead of them into the landing zones, the gunships have also been modified, making them into formidable aerial weapons platforms. During combat missions, the pilots wear chest protectors to give some defense against shrapnel and enemy fire. Their sidearms, which are issued for personal protection, provide just that, and most choose to fly with these placed firmly between their legs. Other unconventional safety procedures are adopted by the grunts, who frequently sit on their helmets during their flight into the combat zone. These precautions still provide little comfort, as the rest of the helicopter is made from a thin shell of aluminium, magnesium, and plexiglass. As a consequence of their construction, one or two hits into a vital area of a chopper can be enough to put it out of action. This makes the helicopter campaign a hugely expensive undertaking, consuming millions of dollars in hardware. Once the shooting stops, however, every effort is made to recover any choppers downed in action. The search and destroy missions are part of a larger strategy to bring South Vietnam back under government control. Once a sweep has been made and an area cleared of enemy units, the ARVN are supposed to move in to mop up and secure the area against further infiltration. Hand in hand with these operations goes another, more subtle aspect in this war of counterinsurgency: the winning of hearts and minds. There is no point in killing the enemy, only to alienate the neutral population. As the troops go about their searches, there is a conscious effort to take what opportunities they can to win the trust of the rural communities. It is a double-edged sword of cooperation or intimidation, which both sides are willing to play. And the Viet Cong know that the discovery of weapons in a village is guaranteed to upset any efforts at local military diplomacy. On January the 30th, 1968, a truce arranged for the Vietnamese New Year is brought to an abrupt end as the Viet Cong launch their Tet Offensive. It is their most ambitious assault of the war. It is also to be their last concerted action. After the initial shock, there is a massive counterattack by US and South Vietnamese troops. Exposed in such large numbers, it is only a matter of weeks before the Viet Cong are all but spent as an effective fighting force. With the virtual destruction of the guerrillas, responsibility for the communist effort in this ever-broadening conflict passes to the North Vietnamese Regular Army. By the spring of 1969, the US Army have over 500,000 personnel in Southeast Asia. After a visit to the region, the Israeli General Moshe Dayan describes American warfare in Vietnam as being primarily helicopter warfare, and the 1st Cavalry as the organizational and tactical expression of the imaginative use of the helicopter in battle. The war has long gone beyond the stage of a conflict which can be won by military might alone. Victory now, however long it takes, is in the hands of the politicians should they choose to talk. As for the helicopters, which started out in this conflict as part of a fragile military experiment, their distinctive sound and silhouette will remain perhaps the most vivid symbol of the war in Vietnam.